welcome to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute is building an interfaith coalition to defend the family. We believe the best for children is mothers and fathers who cooperate in a lifelong union of love, surrounded by a culture that supports these aspirations. You can count on the Ruth Institute to know what they're talking about, and you can count on Dr. J to help you put your faith into action and make a difference. This week, we bring in an expert who will help you defend the truth about marriage and family and human sexuality. And now, here is Dr. J's personal interview with Carrie Gress.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, and welcome to this edition of Dr. J Show. My guest today is Dr. Carrie Gress. Carrie Gress is a doctorate in philosophy from the Catholic University of America, and she's the author of several books, and the one we're going to be talking about mostly today is this one, The Theology of Home. Carrie, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you. It's so great to be here with you.
Well, it's a blast. This book, I love this book. Okay, I loved your two other books. I have one of your books I have on my shelf.
You do, right behind you. I can see it.
Yeah, the Anti-Mary. I couldn't find my copy of the Marian option, which I think is a far better option than Benedict or whatever. But anyway, Carrie, we've known each other for a long time. And you, it does say in your bio, but you have, if I understand correctly, four little monkeys.
One on the way, too.
And one in the oven. Yeah, there you go. Also a mother of five. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your background. You have a doctorate in philosophy, but you're very interested in the issues that lead up to this most unusual book, Theology of the Home. Those are not two things that would normally pair
in
people's minds. So tell us about that.
No, there's definitely a real path that happened that led me from one to the next. But I did a PhD in philosophy. And actually, the funny thing is when I was doing a doctorate, I think I probably even said out loud at one point, I never want to work on women's issues. it was one of those things where I think partially because I just felt like it was a topic that it could be treated way too academically, and it wasn't really touching real lives of real women. That I could, there were very few academic books on women that I could pass along to, say, a sister or a friend and say, you'll really enjoy this. I mean, most of them are filled with a lot of jargon, and they're very, very challenging, and you have to kind of know, you have to have been in philosophy a long time to really even unpack, you know, what they mean by very specific words. They're used in very specific ways. And so I think I was just really felt like that was not where I was called to be at all. And so I ended up writing on human rights, actually, for my dissertation. And then after that, you know, when I became, I finished my PhD shortly after my third child was born. But during that time, you know, I was just really realizing how neglected the topic was of women, from a Catholic perspective. And so I just kept digging into it. And, you know, I even realized just the realization that motherhood is hard. And I think it's supposed to be hard. I think that there's, and that's what Ultimate Makeover, that's what that book is about, is just really looking at how motherhood can take our vices and transform them into virtues. And so I dug into that, and it was partially from my own experience. You know, I went through this stage where I was like, okay, next week it's going to get easier. Next week it's going to be easier. You know, the children won't be sick. I'll get more sleep. You know, whatever it was, there was always something that next week it's going to be easier.
Carrie, I remember the first time it dawned on me, no one is coming.
Yeah,
the relatives have been through and have helped, and been, no one else
You're
is coming.
Done.
I'm on it's my you. Own here.
This is you. Exactly. Yeah. So, and I think that was finally this realization, like, okay, this is a feature, not a flaw. You know, that there's really something going on in my own soul that, even though I'm really struggling, you know, that I'm being changed and transformed very, very slowly. I'm being pulled out of myself. All of the narcissism, all of these things are really being slept off. So anyway, that was the first kind of step into it. And then, of course, I started researching the Marian option. And all of these things just sort of started melding together. And I really saw, you know, how stark of a reality that we live in as Catholic women in the culture, where we are fighting constantly the pressure of really what I've come to call the matriarchy. And I outline, I have a whole chapter on this in the Anti-Mary Exposed, where they control everything that we that comes to us, whether it's, you know, Hollywood, pop culture, novels and fiction, magazines, the fashion industry, all of these things are, what's really behind them is this combination of Marxism and in some cases the occult, and certainly this very pro-abortion culture. And
materialism, philosophical materialism, yeah, and moral relativism, yeah, all of right. that is packed into that.
Exactly. Scene. And you have written about that beautifully as well. Yeah.
Yeah, so keep talking. I got to grab something here.
Yeah.
I got to get this book up front here. This is what she's talking about, everybody.
Yeah.
No, anyway.
I really delved into it, and I just realized, you know, they've sucked all the air out of the room. Like, there's very few places where anybody who's not Catholic can actually find the truth. And even for Catholics, it's hard for us to find the truth.
So pause for just a minute, because we have a lot of non-Catholic viewers and followers. So I just want to say to my Mormon friends, to my evangelical friends who, you know, who are struggling with the same things because, yeah, you know, for all the same reasons, this right. concept that Dr. Gress introduces, this concept of toxic femininity that parallels toxic masculinity, all we hear is how bad the men are. And yeah. by extension, we're supposed to think that we're perfect, but we're only perfect if we do it the way that Carrie just described that these people all
exactly.
promote. And it's frustrating. It's just as frustrating to my Lutheran friends and my evangelical mm-hmm. Free Baptist friends and everybody. Okay, right. so this is what she's talking about, toxic right. femininity. And we've all been, so we're all dealing with this problem.
Mm-hmm. I would say too, you know, I mean, don't be scared off by the concept of Mary, because Mary ultimately, the understanding and the development and appreciation of who our Mary is what undergirds the belief that women are equal to men. You know, yep. it starts with Christ, but that development of her as the perfect model for all Christians, actually both men and women, is really a vital thing. And I think that has, you know, we've kind of thrown the baby out with the bathwater, and that's why we're seeing so many problems, because we don't have her as a real model of fruitfulness, instead of power. We've shifted
right.
the focus to making women powerful and not fruitful. That's really what underpins, I think, the argument generally. So thank you for that, pause. But in any event, so,
right. And then the other side that some people are dealing with at the more traditional end, we're sometimes dealing with people who will treat you like, you know, if you ever hire a babysitter, you're a bad mom.
Right. Exactly. It's amazing,
you know,
isn't
so,
it?
So, yeah. you know, that, right. It's, mm-hmm. it's really hard.
We're just recognizing even the model of womanhood, you know, involves that woman in the Angelus piece of artwork. You know, she's standing out in the field with her husband praying the Angelus at the noon hour. It involves nuns who work outside the convents to sustain themselves. It involves someone like Elizabeth Ann Seton, who was widowed with six children and had to go to work and was shunned because she was a Catholic and not a Protestant by her own community. So I think that, you know, we have to pay attention to real life too. My own mother was widowed, and gratefully she was a stay-at-home mom, but she stayed in touch with my father's business. He was an entrepreneur, and she helped him with it enough so that when he died, she had income and a way to support us. So I think that there's a lot of real life issues that get in the way of people's lives that we don't, you know, it's easy to have these kind of ideals, and the reality is much more complicated usually. So ultimately though, I looked back at my work. I looked back at so much of the amazing work that Catholic women are doing and Catholic men are doing. But so much of it is really on defense. We're sort of defending the faith. And what has we see in the culture is on offense all the time. Look at how beautiful these women are. You know, they weigh 99 pounds. they're in these gorgeous clothes. And this is the lifestyle that we, you know, are presenting to you as the one that you should be striving for. But the reality is that women want more than that. They want rich relationships. They want families. They want great husbands. And, you know, Catholic women is generally are the ones that are not complaining about their husbands, you know, and it largely because we don't use contraception. I mean, there's all these variables that play into why we have incredible marriages. And so I think that was something that I really wanted to put on display. Like, we wanted to go on offense and say, this is something beautiful. This is something that everybody wants. This is something worth emulating. So we put in there, you know, I joke about, you know, that the contraband pictures that we put in there of pregnant women and children and large families and dads that don't look like idiots. And, you know, those are
icons. Icons. Icons right there in the middle.
Exactly. Yes. These are the things that you're not supposed to see in real life. And you don't see them in women's magazines. You just see a very, very narrow understanding of what womanhood means. And it's the kind of definition of womanhood that's not leading to happiness. And we see this, I mean, you see this all the time, Jennifer, in terms of the numbers of suicide and depression, drug abuse, divorce, you know, all of these things are not making women happier. They're in fact feminism has made women much less happy. So how is it that we start getting the message out that there's another way to do this? And so that was really where Theology of Home came from. Was just kind of the opposite side of the coin of, you know, here's the anti-Mary, what's going on. But we have to recognize that the culture is powerfully affected by visuals. And magazines have done an amazing job. You know, a friend of mine, a mutual friend of ours, actually Sue Ellen Browder and I were having a discussion.
Yes.
I adore her.
I do too.
And, you know, she was saying at one point, you know, I don't think we can beat them at their own game. Cause I was saying, why can't we figure out why we don't even have one magazine that you can turn to, you know, maybe Magnolia Journal is probably it. She said, well, I don't think we can beat them at their own game. And I agreed with her at that point. And then over the last few months, I've realized they've beaten us at our game. They have taken the physical. Yeah. That's her great book. They have taken the visual and the physical and the material things, and they are evangelizing the culture with their ideas. They've put Marx in it. They've put Margaret Sanger. You know, all of these philosophies are sort of laced into these very visual products. And, you know, the culture didn't change because women were reading Marx. It changed because they were reading Cosmo.
Right.
So we need to recognize, too, that as wonderful as arguments are that we make all the time, it can only go so far if there's no way to actually get them out there for people to see that there's something attractive and compelling about them. And I think that that's, you know, we kind of need to pivot and start going on offense instead of constantly just trying to make more arguments, because the arguments aren't getting through. But if we could do it visually with beauty and with truth and with goodness, I think, you know, that's when we become kind of unstoppable.
So let me chime in right here, because
Carrie
and I both have doctorates in fairly abstract fields. So for Carrie to say arguments not enough, for a philosophy professor to say arguments not enough, for an economist to say data is not enough, that's a big thing.
Yeah.
You know, that's a big step for us, right?
No.
And so this is accepting the reality that most people need something other than, you know, the front of their brain. You know, there's just much more going on. So that's brilliant that you did that you stepped out of your comfort zone there. And you got some co-authors, including a stupendous photographer.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about your co-authors, just because I think people will be interested in that.
Yeah, well, I mean, just before telling you about them, this was a real almost like identity crisis, because when you spend all this time thinking that ideas are going to really change the world, and then you realize we're in a post-logical, post-rational world, like that's not going to work, you know. It was really challenging for me to sort of give that up and say, okay, this isn't what the culture needs. And of course, you know, I went through all these different phases, like, okay, maybe snark will work, and you know, snark
doesn't
work.
You cannot out-snark the culture. Okay,
right,
I mean, snark
right.
is good, but they'll win. Right. They'll win at that.
Exactly. Yeah. And as much as it amused me, it just wasn't going anywhere else. So yeah. So that was out, you know, obviously I'm not going to go inflict pain on people, you know, they're doing that enough their own. Cause you think of these different ways, how do we get people's attention? And, you know, God, C.S. Lewis calls pain God's megaphone, but obviously it's not my place to be inflicting pain upon anybody.
For me, it was the following. It's a scientifically proven fact that people are not persuaded by scientifically proven facts.
Yes, exactly. So we have to go with what works. And I love the story too of my friend Mary Lisa Carney, who she's featured in the movie Unplanned. She is actually, she became the pro-life sidewalk counselor at in College Station, and then she met her husband Sean Carney, who's now the head of 40 Days for Life. And then the two of them, of course, befriended Abby Johnson. But one of the best things about Mary Lisa, and I've known her for about 9 or 10 years now, we're dear friends, was that I asked her years ago, how is it that you were able to reach these women and help them save their babies? And she said, I started by saying, pointing out something about them that I liked. Oh, I love your hair. I love your handbag. I love your shoes. And this always struck me as very kind of disingenuous. And she's like, no, but it was always authentic. I mean, women know when you're making stuff up. And she said, that was really like what disarmed women. And so, right. I think that that's another piece that we have to recognize is if we can find a place where we can agree with people on things, whether it's our homes or handbags or hair, you start to form a relationship and a trust. And, if you come out of the barn doors blazing with an argument, nobody's going to listen to you. But if you can find this sort of initial point where there's a shared love of something like home, then you have a lot more to go. So anyway, so that's kind of the backstory there with why I pivoted out of philosophy and into, doing something like this. But my co-authors actually, Noelle Maring is a dear friend of mine. She and I went to graduate school together and then kind of lost touch for several years while she was having children and I was living in Europe. And then we got reconnected a couple of years ago. And so she's been an interior designer for a long time. And she's just sharp as a whip. I always tease her. I say, remember the little people, because she's an incredibly gifted writer. And she didn't even know she could write. I asked her to write an article for me a couple of years ago. And from there, it just led from one piece to another. So now she's in the Federalist and National Review and all over. But she's really, really talented writer.
Is she the one you co-authored that article in the Federalist about why women love the home but don't want to be homemakers or something like that? That was really insightful. Yeah. What was the exact title? Tell people the exact title of it.
Why Women Love the Home But Not Being a Homemaker. Mm-hmm. That was it. Yeah. So that's been great. And she and I run our website, theologyofhome.com, which is an aggregate site. And then Megan Schreiber is a designer. Actually, I had been on her podcast a couple of years ago, and we just had a lot of common interests. And so she was involved in definitely in this book. Her house is featured in it. My house is not in the book, but we did some beautiful homes up in Philadelphia. One of them, three stone homes, and one of them is hers. That's how the three of us got pulled together. She designed that gorgeous paper, the end papers in the book.
This stuff.
Every single image there is a symbol of Christ or Our Lady.
And she designed that.
She designed it, and I think she's now making wallpaper and bedding out of it. Yeah, it's really fun.
That's so cool.
Yeah,
I love it. Yeah. Okay, so full disclosure, everybody, my house does not look like this book, okay? My house has never looked like this
book. Mine doesn't either.
Okay, so we're not judging you, okay? That's not the point. That's not the point. So why don't you go through the way, I'm guessing that a lot of the text was yours.
Mm-hmm. A
fair amount of the text was yours. And the way you guys have it laid out, you start with what you call the essentials, and then you talk about the elements. Talk a little bit about some of those pieces and how you put that together.
Yeah, we just went through these sort of different elements of how a home really is meant to exemplify or be a foretaste of heaven. We can all think very quickly of how it can be a foretaste of hell as well. But embedded in all of us is the sense of what home should be like, even those of us who have come from broken homes or, had bad experiences in our homes, we still know what it's supposed to feel like. And, it's a place where we're really supposed to be known and be loved and feel safe and comforted and nourished and, all of those elements. But why? So we laid it out by looking at certainly is Christ as this key figure, that it's this desire for our eternal home, that's really what all Christians are striving for. We want to be at home with God in heaven. And we know Christ is the door to that. So we use that image of Christ as the door and talked about that connection. So there's all these really great transcendentals, you know, the domestic church and the physical church and heaven, you know, all these things sort of allied back together. And that comes out more in the elements, in the elements. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the essentials, it just seemed like it was important to really explain why it is that we desire our homes to be these kinds of sanctuaries and what's happening on a theological level or on the core of our hearts. And, you know, even there, we have a chapter in there on building a home and kind of compare that to, you know, I love all these shows. There's a great documentary series on what's it called? Salt, Fat, Light, and Heat. It's this chef in California, and she goes, you go to all these different places, and you know, one episode's on salt and the other one's on heat, and I guess this can't be light. I can't remember what the four. Anyway, your viewers will know what I'm talking about. But one of them goes to this Italian farmhouse and where they may make olive oil, and they've made olive oil for like 600 years or something. And the visuals are just so compelling, you know, these gorgeous orchards, or I don't even know what you call them, an orchard. Anyway, olive groves where the olives grow and where they're harvested, and then these beautiful stone homes. And, you know, there's something about that I think really stirs something in us. We want that kind of multi-generational heritage, and, you know, there's something beautiful about that. But we know we're not all going to have that. So then how do we even find that on a spiritual level? Because we're called to that also, to generate fruit in our own lives and create, give people the life of Christ and share that and pass that on. So anyway, it was fun to contrast that vision of, the Italian family, and then also contrast that with someone like Elizabeth Ann Seton, who she had six children, and I don't think she ever had grandchildren, actually. I think either her children died too young or they became religious. But she has this whole heritage of all these, you know, saints that came up either through her nuns and through schools and whatnot. So I think that's another element, is this sort of the building up of the kingdom through the saints, that it doesn't just happen on a material level, but on a spiritual. And of course, all these things kind of come together, because you can't do the spiritual without the material. You know, we're not Buddhists, but we recognize the importance of the material as well. So,
you can recognize the materiality of things without becoming a philosophical materialist.
Right.
And I think what struck me in that chapter about the building and those images of that Italian family that you're talking about, right, is the permanence of love.
Yes. You know,
I mean, that's what people want, is reliable love, and the permanence and solidity of the love of that family. And that's what we're all looking for. And that's what Jesus promises us, whether it be here or now, here and now, or later in heaven.
Absolutely.
Interiorly, I think I think you have some things about, you know, finding space for interiority, which no matter what craziness is going on around you, that image of solidity can be brought inside.
No, absolutely. And I think too, obviously, even defining what we mean by love, and that's another element, is that piece of self-sacrifice, of self-gift. And, I think that's why homemaking has such a bad name, partially because of the fact that people don't, you know, for one thing, we've been told it's unimportant. So there's all these pressures on the outside, but we're not seeing the real beauty of it from the inside. And that's what we do with the center chapters called the elements, where we talk about light and safety and nourishment and hospitality and comfort. Because when you look at these in sort of this abstract concept, as an abstract concept, you start seeing that they're real gifts to give to other people. They don't come out of nowhere. And, you know, this is one of the reasons why I think people are searching for home, but they can't quite find it, because these pieces aren't there. There's no one at home to say, you're good, and I want to help you become the person that God intended you to be. And how do we do that? How do we get from, how do we get you to a place where you feel loved and you feel confident that you can be a mature Christian and go out into the world and do what you're supposed to do in it? So I think that's where we've sort of cut ourselves off at the knees, where we're like, we want all these material sort of trappings because they represent what we're really longing for. But unless you have souls that are willing to sort of take on this project of sanctification and of sacrifice, then you can't really get there. But part of the problem is because we haven't painted it in a beautiful light before. And that's really what we wanted to do, was present it in a way that's compelling. And, you know, it's a real, it just feels like an absolute gift to be able to give these things to people that we love instead of just drudgery or slavery or, you know, however.
Instead of looking at other people as dispensers of something mm-hmm. for you, like, right. I'm so fragile, I'm so needy, I need someone to comfort me, I need yeah. someone to build me up. Right. Well, that's only half true.
Yeah.
You know, the other half yeah. of the equation is that I need to give to others.
Exactly.
There's a lot of satisfaction in giving to others. And I feel like it was a big milestone in my son's life, when it became clear that he was enjoying Christmas because of what he was giving other people.
Yeah.
That was right. more important to him than Absolutely. What he got from others. It really yep. mattered to him to choose something appropriate mm-hmm. for that person, mm-hmm. seeing them enjoy it. So it's this kind of paradox of giving in order to receive,
yes.
you know, and mm-hmm. the kind of pure economist model that we're always trying to acquire for ourselves, mm-hmm. that doesn't fly, you know.
Yeah,
And I figured out a long time ago, and I have never quite figured out how to convey it to my economist colleagues, you know, that the self-interest model, you can't paste enough Band-Aids on it.
Yeah.
Really, to make it work, you know, mm-hmm. to overcome that missing element that we just yeah. mentioned. So that, right. so I appreciate that, what you just said.
Yeah, no, and I think that's just it, is that, you know, the narcissism is this bottomless pit that we can keep wanting to fill it and fill it and fill it. And it really will only be filled with God. But part of that being filled with God is exactly that idea of giving of ourselves, that we have been given these gifts that we are meant to share with others, and we're not going to feel fulfilled until we have the capacity or the ability to see that that needs to happen. So yeah, no, I think it's it is that ironic piece, you know, that sort of pearl hidden in the field, you know, that it's not obvious or self-evident to anybody, and yet when you start digging into it, that's really where the joy comes, and the peace and all of those things that we're striving for, are, that's kind of the recipe for it. So yeah, I think that's a great point.
Yes. So one of the elements that you have in here that really appeals to me is the element of hospitality.
Mm-hmm.
So just talk about that. You've got some beautiful yeah. stuff in here. And there's so much in the scripture
yes,
that so one can refer to for mm-hmm. for hospitality.
Absolutely.
And there's a beautiful passage. I want to say it's in Jesus's farewell discourse, where he tells them all that I'm going to make, in my Father's house there are many mm-hmm. rooms, right. and I'm going ahead to make a place for you.
Right.
And one time I was listening to that, and I had this image of kids going off to college and then coming back home, right?
Oh,
and,
neat. Yeah.
And when your mom's coming back, when you're coming back home, the whole family's in a flurry to make yeah. you, because they're excited, big brother's coming back or whatever it is.
Right.
And
right.
I had this image of Mary, the mother of God, mm-hmm. Freshening up our room for us, oh, you know, just right. fluffing the pillows
yeah.
and putting clean
yeah.
sheets on and making right. it all light and putting flowers in there. Oh, she's coming home from college.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
Kind of thing. This, you know, we've been sent out. I mean, college, that's like, it's a round trip in the
yeah.
home. You know, you
yeah.
leave, but you come back, you know.
Right. Right. No, and I think that that's such a great image, because my kids are still too young. They're not, obviously, you know, the oldest is 10, but I can imagine that excitement of having them come back. You know, you miss them intensely, and to be right. able to not only have them come back, but be able to welcome them, you know, as richly as possible. I think that's just an exciting thing. You know, that joy of being reunited as a family is really exciting.
And the younger kids really feel it. I mean, this is what
yeah.
I've seen in families. I mean,
right.
we only had two children, so we didn't mm-hmm. see this so much. But I remember it when I was a little girl, I remember when my big brothers would come home, you know, and I see this in other families that they're looking forward to big sister coming back or, you know, whatever it is, it's really.
No, it's super sweet. So
it's very sweet. Very sweet.
I think, and I think too, that the idea, you know, one of the ideas that I loved the most that came out of this book was just the fact that we can't always get people to church, but we can get them into our homes. We can get them over for a dinner, for a meal. And just how, you know, we think of it in very simple terms, but if you're living a very rich life, Christian life, there's so many things that are happening on a level that is just so different than what the culture is offering. And I think people are really starved for to just be loved, really, to have people recognize them for who they are, not want anything from them, but to really delight in having, you know, here these people in our home. Isn't this great? Let us get to know you better and share about ourselves. And, you know, all of these kinds of things that happen without speaking, but that I think edify a soul. And I remember being single and spending time with some big families and just leaving and feeling like I was more who I was meant to be. And I couldn't put my finger on why, but it was just that being known as a person instead of just another number or just another student in someone's classroom or, you know, what have you. It was very personalized and focused in on an individual soul. And so I think that that's something that we can definitely give to people and that can happen in the home in a way it can't happen. You know, even if you meet out at a restaurant, I think it's much harder to do that because it's all those little details of the table setting and then even the process of table clearing. In fact, I was last weekend, I was joking with somebody on a panel about how she was saying, oh, well, my guests never do the dishes. And of course, I'm chiming in saying my guests always help me with the dishes because I just couldn't entertain if I didn't, you know, I can't leave these dishes for the next day. I still have children to tend to and take care. Like entertaining will not happen if, you know, the women and I do not go to the kitchen and start cleaning up something because it's just too much work for me to do. Given all of my other responsibilities. So, you know, I think there's all these different ways that families do this, but it's that shared experience and, you know, that time of people just sitting together and enjoying each other and not necessarily talking about politics or hot button issues, but in fact, probably veering away from them and getting to the more personal and to stories and to, you know, engaging on that level. And certainly with Thanksgiving and that, you know, the holidays upon us, I know people are thinking about this a lot and, I think it'd be really challenging because we also want to share our faith, but at the same time, we can't be too heavy-handed. You know, nobody wants to feel like they're being sold something. And so I think that's another important element of it is hospitality is meant to be a gift to the other. And even though we see our faith as a gift, they might not receive it that way and see it that way. So it's, I think that the bonds of friendship really need to take root in deep, deep ways before any kind of evangelization on an apologetic sort of way can take place, unless, of course, it comes up naturally. But, you know, we've all been in those dynamics, and I know I have tried in years past with much failure, you know, trying to tell people about the faith and share it with them, and it's just, you know, it's like a lead balloon and tends to push people away. Versus just this encounter where you're just saying it's good that you're here and we're happy to have you here and how can we serve you? I think that goes a lot further in terms of helping people learn to trust you and understand that you know you're not just trying to sell them and you don't just love them when they become a Christian, but you love them exactly where they're at, no matter where they're at in their life.
Right. That's really interesting. You know, I don't know if you know this about us, Carrie, but our family, we have two children. We have an adopted son and we have a birth daughter. I think you may have met them both. I think you've met Anne. You've met Anne,
I know. Anne's had lunch with us, actually.
Yeah, I know you've met Anne. But we also did foster care for a number of years.
Oh, wow. I didn't realize that. Yeah.
Yes. When our kids were school age, middle school, high school kind of thing, we had foster kids who were between age 6 and 12.
Wow.
And so a lot of these, so they were companions. My kids look back very fondly on that period of time because they felt like they had more siblings. And, you know, this was the only way we could provide them with siblings.
Right.
So, okay, what the heck, you know?
Yeah.
Naturally, I thought, as an economist, I thought, well, I'm home with two children. I might as well be home with four. You know, it's economies of scale and all of that.
Right,
you know?
Right.
So it was a lot
very
of fun.
Practical.
But you saw the kids You know, we were giving them comfort and we were giving them safety and we were giving them friendship and so on. But they wanted their parents. You know, they wanted it to be okay with their parents. And that's what they really wanted. Yeah. And so this receptivity that you're talking about was a very much part of our lives, because even when we were thinking, oh, my God, these parents, whatever, you know, you could never say anything bad about them,
right,
because that's who their kid, that's who they wanted.
Right.
And so therefore we had to want that, you know, we had to want that, that it would somehow be okay,
you know,
for them to come and then go, you know, and I forget why that came. Hospitality. Mm-hmm. That's why it came to my mind. Was hospitality. Was that kind of, let me show you something. I keep moving away from the table here.
It's a good thing you got wheels.
So we had this made. We had this on our door for the years that we were doing foster care.
Oh, that's so great. Yeah.
So we thought that was kind of fun. And you can see we were in San Diego.
Palm tree. Oh, that's so
that was
sweet.
Back in the day. But
yeah.
But yeah, I think the apostolate of friendship is a real apostolate.
Yeah. You know,
I mean, that's real form of evangelism. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't want to bring people in and feed them raw bread or something. You know,
you should at least cook it.
Yeah.
No, I actually, recently I talked to a mother of nine, and all of her kids have stayed within the church. She had one that sort of left briefly and then came back. And she said they all got together recently and were talking about, you know, what it was that kind of kept them glued to the faith. And she said, you know, part of it was that she was home, and she had this place where their friends knew that they could always come and they were welcome and there would be rich discussion. And, you know, that there would be this sort of home life that they may not have had in their own lives. And yet they found it there. And so rather than her kids always leaving and spending time with other people and other places and her never knowing what was going on, you know, she became kind of this home base. And of course, there were other factors in it. But, you know, she said that she had been encouraged to sort of stop homeschooling and get involved in some kind of apostolic work. And she said, well, this is my apostolic work, you know, this building of this home and making this a place where people feel really welcome. And so I think that that is a piece that we have really neglected tremendously in terms of just what a domino effect that can have on the lives of others, and just transforming the culture specifically is just the abandonment of the home. You know, what happens if there are places where people feel like there's always room at the inn, you know, like at your house. So
We have a lot of non-Catholic viewers, and they're all over the place. You know, we have right. Orthodox people who are, of course, have no problem with images at all. Mm-hmm. Latter-day Saints have no problem with religious art. But some of our Protestant friends are a little squeamish or nervous about religious imagery. And so I wonder if you could just say a few words to them about, you know, about thinking through kind of the boundaries between religious art that's somehow inspiring versus violating the commandment against graven images and stuff like that. Could you just say a few words that might help them think that through?
You know, that was one of the things that we wanted to do in this book. Was we didn't want every page to feel like you were hit over the head with religious art, but to also recognize the beauty. You know, we know what the definition of beauty is based on the medievals, that we have some very rich categories, things like order and brilliance and clarity, symmetry, these kinds of things that we have from the medievals.
Whatever you're going to choose to do as your inspirational religious decor, however you want to describe that, it's better if it's of quality.
Right. And it's done well. And and even look at Europe. Why do people love going to Europe? It's because of the richness of Catholic culture, these principles of symmetry. And you know, David Clayton does an amazing job of pointing out, you know, proportionality in buildings and in architecture, and why the soul finds rest in an older building versus a modern building, and all of those elements. So I think that we have a lot of examples of the way that the church knows how to do this well. I think we've just abandoned them. I think there's a lot of myths about what Catholics are willing to spend money on and what we, how we decorate our homes. And I think there's even sort of this pervasive sense that we have to be very austere, or and that gets mixed up with shabbiness and whatnot. But again, if you look at convents, there's nothing shabby. It can still have an austerity to it that's very elegant and that's still compelling and good for the soul. Now, I say all of this, of course, you know, with small children. In fact, I loved it this week. Marie Kondo, who has had her own children, she's this style guru. Throw everything out that's not useful or beautiful. She says she can't uphold her own standards of home organization because she has toddlers now. So I think we also have to recognize that there are going to be stages in our life where we're just going to have extra junk and things are going to be messy and things are going to feel out of control, you know, until you sort of get your teenagers trained to do the dishes. And, you know, if that ever happens, you know, those kinds of things are just really our real challenges. And so we have to have kind of expectations for the season of life that we're in versus, you know, feeling like we're a failure if we're not living up to the Marie Kondo standard when we have, you know, four children under three.
So now, you know, the other thing that brings me to another thing is that it's the vibe of this book. Is that mm-hmm. This is a book for women. This is a book to help women and to give women a vision of what their lives and their homes can be like. So in that sense, it's a feminine book. But I do want to say, I want to talk with you mm-hmm. about our husbands. You know, right. My husband is, I would say, allergic to knickknacks.
Yeah.
Okay. Like knickknacks are like
can't do them.
They will be either banished or or ridiculed.
Right. Really, right. You know. Ridiculed out of existence. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he's a very practical guy. So that's therefore our home has a certain personality.
Right.
Right. But I wonder if you could say something about creating space in the home where the husband feels like this is his home too, you know, where he can feel free to do his projects or whatever, you know, whatever it might be. Right. Can you talk about that a little bit?
I've actually had people say to me, you know, I opened this book and I was just in tears because they found a place, they finally found a place where they felt like they were heard and they were seen and that this was something that spoke to them. This wasn't just another magazine where you were like skipping through ads that, you know, are offensive to you or articles or, you know, that somehow misses the mark. But in fact, it really speaks to, I think the heart of women who are just doing so much that we're not giving them enough support for. So I will say that. But I think the same.
They need to be affirmed.
Absolutely.
What women are doing, what mothers are doing, they deserve to be affirmed. And this is one way to do it. Absolutely.
Yeah. No, and that's one of the reasons why people don't want to be homemakers, because there's no affirmation out there in the culture. All you get is pushback. You know, I've been amazed at 46 and having my fifth child and just, you know, you would think that people didn't have any manners, you know, like maybe
they don't,
you know, congratulations should probably be the only thing that you say. You know, I don't need to hear about how my family size is getting ridiculous or, you know, it's just amazing what people are willing to say.
Do you know what causes that?
That's another.
I mean, how many times you hear that?
One woman said, you're not supposed to do that. Like, what are you talking about? Anyway, it's pretty incredible what people are willing to say.
It is.
I think, you know, in light of that, again, all the more reason that we need support for that. But I think the same is true for men. Obviously, you as an economist know this much better than I do, you know, that there's was this major shift with the Industrial Revolution, and we have went from sort of household economies where the man and the wife were home together and kind of working elbow to elbow, or at least they were home and much more. And he would, you know, this is why you've got these great big lunches still in Italy that are 2 and 3 hours long, because the father would come home and everybody would have this big lunch and then a small dinner. And, you know, that meal pattern hasn't changed all that much. But the family has changed significantly. So in light of that, you know, we have women that are home and men aren't home as much, but that doesn't mean that we make them feel like aliens in their own home. And I think that that's another piece that women in particular can do a great service to. I remember at one point, I had really little kids and I was probably pregnant with my third child. And I overheard my husband say something like to one of his friends, like, oh, yeah, my I usually get home and my wife throws the kids at me and I just end up taking over. And he wasn't being rude about it, but it was one of these things where I was like, wow, I'm sure that he's got to be exhausted when he gets home. And the last thing, you know, it's got to be incredibly challenging for him to sort of shift gears and all of a sudden be a you know, engaged in all of this chaos and mayhem of toddlers. And so I tried to sort of buffer that a little bit more and give him a sort of some breathing room and whatnot. So I think there's all kinds of levels, but at the same time, I think we also, you know, being a father and a big family does incredible things. It can either make you a worse man or make you a better man. And, right. You know, so many men rise to the occasion and become incredible men because they do realize, like, you know, it's sort of showtime when you get home that you've got these souls, that this is the real purpose for all of our efforts and work is to get these souls to heaven. So there's that balance, but it is important to make sure, I think, that men feel like they have a home. You know, my husband's always teasing me about throw pillows. Why do we have so many throw pillows? You know, I think that's the eternal mystery of throw pillows. And of course, I never have a very good answer. Like, they just look nice, you know. So yeah. I can appreciate your husband's knickknack allergy to a certain degree. But yeah, I think it's just a matter of giving them also room to sort of decompress and also just even making sure that they feel like they have time to go on retreat or to work for in their own spiritual life, because that's obviously not going to be happening in a 9-to-5 job or with a long commute or whatever. Those are hard things, you know, giving them time to be with other men, all of that. So, yeah, the home is, and even just the importance of, you know, a good meal. Gratefully, my husband loves to cook. So he does, during the week, he doesn't cook very much, but on the weekends, he does a fair amount of the cooking. And, you know, it's one of these things where we've just gotten to the place where I know when he cooks, I'm going to do the dishes. When I cook, I do the dishes. Like, it's just part, it's not a complaint. It's just kind of the way that it works. Right. And then he has time to actually be with the children, which is great for the kids as well. So I think every family has to kind of work out those dynamics of how, what is needed, and are there places where, whether it's a wood shop or, you know, something that particular men have a hobby that you can kind of create space for. I think that's important too. So harder when you have small children, I think, but as they grow, that's becomes an even more beautiful thing for the kids to be involved in. If, you know, dad's workshop, you can imagine those memories that would be created.
I have those memories from my own dad, and I know my sisters do as well. And I know my kids, you know, have those memories of,
because
my husband's one of these guys who's always got projects going on, you know, and when they were little, he was always doing stuff. And standing there watching dad do whatever, you know, that's right. And I must say, one of the things I noticed in this book is, you know, most of the images are of the home, and there are a number of kids being safe kind of photos. But some of the most compelling ones are the ones that do have men in them.
Yeah.
That one with the father helping the kids come up up to the treehouse.
Right.
You know, there's the ladder, and he's like urging them on. You know, that was a very beautiful photo, and a beautiful image of a father's love.
Yeah.
Well, so this is really a beautiful book, Carrie. I'm so taken with this book. And one of the things that we like to do on the Dr. J Show is we like to give people something to do. We always like to give people action items.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to tell people flat out, you need to go buy this book. You need to share this book with young families. If you know any young mothers who are home alone, you know, maybe have this kind of isolation feel that Carrie's talking about, this is a very good gift. For them. So that's Dr. J's action item. Carrie, is there any other thing that you would like to encourage our viewers to do or participate in, get involved in?
Well, where do I start? I think, you know, the bigger thing is we need to start paying attention to the women in this culture and how they're absorbing content. And, you know, I would love to see 1,000 things spur off of this. If other people that have a similar mindset and feel like, oh, yes, we have the capacity to give visually compelling, but also really solidly true content to women. Because a part of the problem, and we see this all the time, you know, we're talking about kids going away to college. Well, the daughter or the son goes away to college and they completely lose their faith. Why? Because the only thing that's really compelling is what we're getting from the matriarchy. There aren't options out there. And so they're sort of shamed or, you know, the sense of being cool into abandoning the faith that they grew up with. And so I think we need to do a better job of sort of reclaiming these visuals and just saying, pointing out the destruction that's actually happening from this while at the same time showing the beauty of what it really is like to live a life within God's laws and love, that's really where the flourishing is. That's really what women want. Because the culture is not going to change. We can change laws and those will have a limited effect. But in terms of changing the actual hearts of women, they become so hardened. Yes. We need to find a way to reach them. And, you know, some of it's got to start with things like, I love your hair. I love your shoes. I love your handbag.
Right, it's
got to start on this very basic friendship level instead of feeling like it always has to be, you know, this huge argument that we've well constructed.
Do you have a website or a blog or newsletter, anything like that people can subscribe to?
Exactly. Yeah, it's theologyofhome.com, and it's actually an aggregate site where we compile both articles about the faith, but we also compile things like, you know, traveling or you know, dealing with in-laws or gardening or whatever. It's a whole array of content that's of interest to women, rather than just being very focused on specific theological issues. And I think that's what women do well. You know, we can jump from topic to topic very, very easily and nimbly, and we're interested in improving ourselves and improving our minds and making our homes better, making our work easier, making our relationships go more smoothly. And, you know, all this can't happen on the church level or at the parish level. We don't, we can't expect it to come from there, but we need to have, you know, women providing this kind of support for other women. Again, the way that the culture has been kind of evangelizing us with these awful ideas for 50 years, we need to take some of that back. And so that's really what I would encourage your viewers to do, is just think of different ways, either financially to support things that are going to be helpful to women, or to be creative and you know, develop a line of products. We actually have developed a line of candles specifically for this reason, because there's so many secular candles out there, but why are we not using the beauty and the sense of the Catholic faith to gift people with a candle? So I think that there's a lot of opportunities out there for us, because it's just a wasteland, really.
Right.
When you look at how we are involved in the marketplace. So I think there's a lot of exciting opportunities if we have the humility to look at how women are influenced and move in that direction.
So theologyofthehome.com.
Theologyofhome.com. Yep.
Thanks very much, Carrie. This has been a really fun conversation.
Thank you.
And I know a lot of people are going to be blessed by it. Okay. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Dr. J's personal interview with Carrie Gress, author of The Theology of Home. The family founded on marriage is truly the sanctuary of life, the place in which life, the gift of God, can be properly welcomed and protected against the many attacks to which it is exposed, and can develop in accordance with what constitutes authentic human growth. The family's role in promoting and building the culture of life against the possibility of a destructive anti-civilization, as so many present trends and situations confirm, is decisive and irreplaceable. And now for the most important part of our program, your action item for this week. Share this episode of the Dr. J Show with the young families in your life. Get The Theology of Home and give the book as gifts, especially for mothers who may be questioning the value of the time they're spending in the home. Subscribe to Carrie's List and to her podcast. Incidentally, Dr. Morse's first book was all about motherhood. It's called Love and Economics. It takes a family to raise a village. I'm gonna let it shine. This is And that's our action item for this week.
Praise God. Amen. You may be seated.
In Titus 2, that says that women are to be keepers at home. Verses 3 through 5 says, older women likewise are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good, and so train the young women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. In the King James it says keepers at home, in the NASB it says workers at home, and in the Darby translation it says diligent in homework. It is clear for us to see that homemaking or being a keeper at home is a role or job that God has specifically given to women, mothers, wives. And because it is mentioned so often in scripture, it's something that we should take seriously. It's something that we should be passionate about. Because homemaking and being a keeper at home is always mentioned when it comes to like listing qualities a godly woman and wife and mother. Homemaking and being a keeper at home isn't something that we should be ashamed of, because it is something that God has called us to.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.